Okay, folks, welcome to our Friday Chapel service. This Friday Chapel service is a little bit unusual. Actually, it's a pre-recorded chapel service. This is because right now I should be in Cambodia. I am closing a Habitat for Humanity project sponsored by Far East organization this week. So I thought I would record it first and share with you again some messages, especially related to the kind of work that I do. So for today, I want to think a little bit about the charitable work and why is it that, you know, you want to focus on stuff like that. And the title of today's sharing is called The Hole in the Gospel. So we break away from the preaching of Mark in honor of the occasion right now. And this is a project that has been going on for almost six years. And it is a large-scale project. We are building more than 1,500 houses in various places in Cambodia, thanks to the generosity of CEO and also other many different kind of things that is going on, training for the people and helping the capacity to fight poverty and all that. So quite a few things that's happening. But because I am trying to record this, of course, beforehand, and it is a little bit tricky to record things to play back again. So I hope there is no issue. So if there's some technical glitch, so please be a little bit patient with me. Nonetheless, we can worship together wherever we are, thankfully for all this technology that the Lord has enabled us to have. So I'm going to call out the slides right now and share with you. Let me see, where's my slideshow? Okay, there it is. And let's share this again. And at the same time, I want to show my face. Ah, there you go. So we are okay now. So the first song that I want to lead and share with all of you is called Lord, We Lift Your Name Up High. So let's sing this wonderful, wonderful song together.
Your name on high.
Okay, that was a wonderful, wonderful song. Let's come to God in a time of opening prayer. Let's pray. We thank you, God, for the technology that enable ministry work to carry on all around the world in such a marvelous manner. But technology aside, it's really all about us coming before you with a heart that is sincere, a heart that is pure, a heart that is willing to come close to you. And so right now, wherever we may be, whether we are watching this live, watching this on record, or you know, maybe several days even later, we do want to pray that you grant us a heart that is humble and teachable before you, childlike, so that we can recognize your voice. For you always would oppose the proud and give grace to the humble. Help us to treasure the moment and opportunities that you've given to us, for this is not the case for many people around the world. So this moment of time, may we truly be deemed to be pleasing in your sight, for you are our Lord and our Redeemer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The next song is another wonderful song, In Moments Like This. You know, just now in the prayer, I was talking about how we really sometimes just take for granted, right, all the time that God has given to us. So let's sing this song and remember that the moments that you've given to us are very special indeed.
See you.
All right, what a wonderful and sweet song this is. For anthem today, because of what I'm going to be sharing, I have picked a song that you may have heard before. I played it before by Chris Rice, Go Light Your World. This is one of my most favorite hymn, or rather contemporary song that this songwriter Chris Rice has written. And I really do appreciate the song. It's, I don't know why it's not more popular than I think it should be. It talks about how we are given a light and we need to go and light the world for Jesus Christ's sake. Let's enjoy this together.
There is a candle in every soul, some brightly burning, and some dark and cold. And there is a spirit who brings a fire, ignites a candle, and makes his home. Carry your candle. Run to the darkness, seek out the helpless, confused and torn, and hold out your candle for all to see it. Take your candle and go light your world. Take your candle. Frustrated brother, see how he's tried to light his own candle some other way. See now your sister, she's been robbed and lied to, still holds a candle without a flame. So carry your candle. Hearts are blazing, so let's raise our candles and light up the sky, praying to our Father in the name of Jesus. Make us a beacon in darkest times. Carry your candle, run to the take your candle and go light your
All right, isn't that the most wonderful song? It's one of those songs that you can listen to many times, and I've heard it so many times. And still, you know, every time I listen to it, it really touches my heart. The lyrics that's written, the wisdom in the way that the Chris Rice crafted the whole thing together is just most marvelous. Today, like I said, I want to be sharing with you a topic relating to one of the work that I do. Is there a hole in the gospel? Now, I want to share with you that when I was invited to be chaplain of Fire's organization by CEO Philip Ng, I had to pray about it for a long time, right? And also, I also gave him some sort of condition, I suppose, because, you know, I'm a national director of Habitat for Humanity, and that's a Christian charity that built houses for the poor, or rather fight poverty by focusing on shelter-related issue. And, you know, chaplaincy is also a work that is heavy, and the workload is going to be big as well. And at the same time, I'm a pastor of my own, well, not my own church, but the Reformed Evangelical Church Singapore. So that belongs to a bigger denomination that's based in Jakarta, actually. So the thing is about it is that I just am quite insistent that if I am to be chaplain, I don't want to give up my work as National Director of Habitat for Humanity, which is a work dealing with charity. And thankfully, CEO is very kind, and of course, he's a wonderful guy. He absolutely support all this work. So you may wonder, you know, why so troublesome? Why are we going to do so many weird or heavy burden work in life? And today, I hope to maybe share with you guys a little bit why that's the case. And it's a little bit unorthodox, isn't it? Most of the time when you think about a pastor or somebody who is pastoring a church or even a chaplain, it's like that's about the only thing that the person would do. But for me, this is something that is just a part of ministry. And this other part of ministry, a consistent work towards the alleviation of poverty and the helping of the disadvantaged, it's always been a part of my life ever since I was even a teenager. So I entitled this sharing, Is There a Hole in the Gospel? Because this was inspired by an actual book that's written by a guy called Richard Stern, entitled The Hole in Our Gospel. Richard Stern is the president of the World Vision America. Now, World Vision is the world's largest and most successful Christian charity. And my charity is Habitat for Humanity, and I am the founder and national director of the branch in Singapore. And Habitat for Humanity is actually 10 times smaller than World Vision. World Vision is our partner. Habitat is very focused on shelter-related issue, whereas World Vision really do a lot of things. They basically, you know, almost do everything. And when they need shelter-related solution, then they will come and look for Habitat. But they also feed the poor, they do education work, they do overall development work in a village, they do gender empowerment, economical training, anything that has to do with poverty fighting. They are most famous for the Adopt a Child kind of a scheme, which maybe some of you even join World Vision to sponsor a child kind of scheme. They were one of the earliest to have something like that. And this kind of work or this question of the hole in the gospel came about because Richard Stern, as president of World Vision USA, would often have to go and figure out how to raise money, how to go and deal with this issue, right? And as he talked to church leaders and Christians alike, he began to ask the question, you know, what is it? Why is it that we have so much issues in the world when there are already so many Christians, especially in the United States, right? You have a lot of very rich Christians. So therefore, he then wrote this book. Now, when we look into the world today, really like Stern has observed, and I think any one of you could say the same thing, the state of humanity today is really quite horrifying, right? There are about 800 million people who are hungry right now as we speak. And there are 3.1 million children will die of hunger this year. Now, these are all very rough figures, we all know. At the same time, we are also very aware that the actual figure cannot be too far away from this, you know. Malaria will kill 1.5 million to 2.7 million people this year. and 37 million people have been infected with HIV, with more than 36 million people dying of AIDS since 1981. Now, HIV would then kind of progress to AIDS in some cases. And you know that the world, this is like just a sampling of the issues of the world, right? It's so depressing to think about so many issues, whether you've got poverty, water, sanitation, education, crime, violence, slavery, child prostitution, exploitation, human trafficking, pollution, war, environmental issue, conflict. Wow, you just go on and on and on. You realize that the state of humanity is a pretty dim kind of situation. You really don't want to go and think too much about it, isn't it? But then if they are right there every day when you go out there in the rest of the world, you do see poverty and terrifying situation everywhere. Singapore is a very unusual country. We are very blessed and we are the exception in this whole world, you know, a place where there is clean drinking water, safety for most of our, for almost all our women. I mean, our women can go home late at night and they are not overly worried. I have two daughters, and if when they come back home and late at night, I'm not going to stay on the door and wait for them because this is a very safe place. So safe that when my youngest daughter did an exchange program to London, I had to keep reminding her, you must remember that that's not Singapore. And you really want to be very, very careful, you know, who is where, outside of Singapore, anything can happen. So please be very careful. But still within a paradise-like country in Singapore, right in our doorstep, we do have poverty as well. This is a picture of an old woman that I encountered in one-room flat. In Singapore, the poorest people all live in a one-room flat. She was bedridden because she was paralyzed from the waist down. First time I met her, she was, the whole place just smell of human waste because, you know, she couldn't go to the toilet. So she basically did a business in the bed. And then the wall was very, had this abstract art looking thing because it was filled with stains of blood. So what happened is that other than the place smelling like crazy, it was also crawling with bed bugs. And you see this picture is very blurred because I used the BlackBerry. So it shows you how long ago, a BlackBerry at that time, the resolution of the cameras were not good. And what she did was she just get a big bug on her bed and then smash it against the wall, and that leave a blood stain. And then when it dries up, it becomes looking like an abstract art, you know, brown color stuff. So it's very, quite a horrible situation right there. So in Singapore, we also have situations like this. Now, the reason why you bring out questions like that is because when I go around telling people about work like this, especially even within the Christian circle, people kind of look at you strange and tell you that, you know, yeah, we know that helping the poor is important, but as Christians, our number one priority is to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I'm sure you may feel that way as well, right? This is an evangelical kind of emphasis. So when we think about the purpose of Christianity and the purpose of a Christian, and we talk about gospels and stuff like that, there are actually a lot of questions that are not answered, you know. What exactly are you talking about when you use the word gospel message? When you preach the gospel message to someone, what is it that we are trying to accomplish? Is it just a message or some kind of a idea that we should just propagate it to other people? And you look at the way many churches do evangelism, it's almost like a product to be marketed, isn't it? I mean, we are honest to ourselves, you see that a lot of such things going on. And interesting marketing sound bites, very interesting graphics, or somebody put posters or whatever it is. And it's as if you're trying to sell something to someone. And then when I go talk to pastors about the work that we do, especially when I first started Habitat Singapore, and that's in the year 2004, good, you know, coming to 20 years already. Oh, I'm feeling a bit old here. I remember talking to pastors and preachers and church leaders about the work we do. After all, we are Christian charity. And one of the things that always came back is that, you know, can we go convert these people when we help them, like that old lady in that one room flat? And if you say you cannot convert them because Habitat does not have a proselytizing kind of anger, so we do not go and tell people that, hey, you know, if you want me to build you a house to get you out of the slum, you go become a Christian, then we'll help you. We don't do things like that because it's not a fair deal, you know. it's also a kind of exploitation, actually, proselytizing, a hard sell evangelism. So we don't do things like that. But when you go tell a pastor that you don't do things like that, very often one of the response is then we are not interested, because we only want to help people who can be Christian or at least potentially become Christians. And if they don't have any potential to become Christians, then we are really not too interested in this. It's a waste of our time. And seriously, I've heard many, many people tell me that we only want to help people who will somehow, I don't know, advance the kingdom of God. You know, those are some of the words we use. So therefore, as Richard Stern has asked, is there a hole in our gospel? That kind of understanding, is there a gaping hole in that? And, you know, we don't think about this very much because we are so used to the evangelical message, right? That the Great Commission, you go and preach the gospel, all that kind of thing. And we are very fixated on that. And right around us, there are so many people already talking about evangelism and what have you, and set up shops and do a lot of things about evangelism. So when you think about the gospel of Jesus Christ only in pure evangelism terms, is there something quite wrong with it? So what exactly is the gospel? The fact is that the Bible is really filled with commands that we help the poor, that we uphold social justice, we defend the fatherless, and et cetera, as we do live our life every single day. And you cannot escape from it, you know. Take, for example, from the Old Testament, Ezekiel 16, verse 49. Now, this was the sin of your sister Sodom. So Ezekiel was talking about the sin of Sodom and Gomorrah, which we are very used to the story in Genesis, where God rained fire and brimstone and destroyed the city. Many people sort of assume that, oh, these two are homosexual cities. With part of it is true, they have the sin of homosexuality. But here you see one sin that's listed by the prophet Ezekiel. She and her daughters were arrogant, overfed, and unconcerned. They did not help the poor and the needy. So Ezekiel said that because they did not help the poor and the needy, therefore, it's a big sin. And, you know, that's just one example of a verse in the Bible. There are just numerous verses in the Bible that talk about how we need to help the poor. The fact is that if we were to physically cut out portions of the Bible relating to poverty alleviation, and I've actually mentioned this in previous sharing before, then you actually have a holy Bible that cannot be read. Go try it. I mean, from the first page of the Bible, you read down, and anything that has to do with the Bible commanding us to help the poor, you cut it out physically or blanco it lah. Don't destroy the page. Use a marker and cover it up. You will find that it is not possible for you to read the Bible that way. And it is not something that is doable. So then to the question of whether we should put priority in preaching the gospel or put priority in helping the poor, may I suggest to you that from the Bible, and it's not my invention, from the Bible, it is not a question of the gospel or helping the poor. It is the gospel and helping the poor. Both are parallel things that we need to do. And this is a very important understanding, that like the twin parallel track of a train, the preaching of the gospel of Jesus Christ and the helping of people made in his image and likeness, both must run parallel to each other. You can't have one without the other. You cannot possibly say that you love God and you serve God, but you hate and people who are made in his image and likeness. I mean, clearly, 1 John chapter 4, for example, tell you that if you say that, you are a liar. It's not possible to say that you will love God whom you cannot see, but you hate your brother whom you can see, and you kind of refuse to help them. So this is a very important teaching in the Bible, that if you take away all the commandments that talk about helping the poor, you don't have a Bible. In the same way, if in your life as a Christian, you really do not lift a finger to help anybody who is poor, including the non-Christians, may I suggest to you that then the gospel you understand as a gaping hole in it. But there are some people who sort of say that, hey, you know, you are talking about a resource distribution issue, that, you know, there's not enough money. I don't have enough money to help anyone. Where are the resources going to come from? You know, ever since I was young, I've heard this a long time ago when I was in primary school. You read about how the world is going to have so many people that we're not going to be able to feed every mouth. So therefore, we better do not go over promise people that they will receive help or whatever it is. And poverty is like, some people say that poverty is nature's way to cull the flock, lah. You know, those weak, they sort of deserve to die, right? When you look at the Bible again, Deuteronomy chapter 15, verse 1. And this is a chapter about the year where you cancel debts for the Israelite. At the end of every 7 years, you must cancel debt. That's from verse 1. But the key emphasis I want to put on is verse 4. The Bible says, however, there should be no poor among you, for in the land your Lord, your God, is giving you to possess as your inheritance, he will richly bless you. This is an important verse, you know. Deuteronomy chapter 15, verse 4, it says there should be no poor among you. Because why? God will allow all of us to have a land that is richly blessed. So, my dear brothers and sisters in Christ, I am convinced that God has created a world with more than enough resources for every single human being, because that's how God works. He's not going to create a world where there's not enough to sustain the human being that he has created. So much so that Deuteronomy 15:4 will promise that there should be no poor among you. But the key verse comes next. Verse 5, if only you fully obey the Lord your God and are careful to follow all these commands I am giving you today. So that's the caveat. If only you follow your Lord your God. When you put this all together and you think about the issue of poverty, of people not having enough, the bottom line should go like this. We actually have all the money we need to solve world hunger, poverty, illiteracy, to cure malaria, to give clean water to every single poor person, to feed every hungry mouth in the world, including the children. We have all the resources we need in the world today. As I speak, we already have it. However, the only problem is that the money is inside your pocket, because that's what's happening now. And Deuteronomy 15 says that, you know, if only you would do the work of God, and if only you obey to God. And we are talking about the whole of humanity, of course. So the issue of poverty got nothing to do with the lack of resources, actually. I mean, you look at food waste, you look at all these tons of waste that we have. We know that there is enough. The only problem is in the distribution, isn't it? And why are we not distributing? Because we are fallen people. We are not obeying the commands of our Lord. And these are very profound understanding and profound issues. And in my life, I have been very, very influenced by a Christian writer called Dorothy Sayers. And I've shared this with some of you before. And she was a person who wrote during the time of J.R.R. Tolkien, who wrote The Lord of the Rings. And of course, Tolkien is a lot more famous than Dorothy Sayers, because, you know, Lord of the Rings made into a movie and this and that. Dorothy Sayers actually on the side also wrote detective stories and stuff like that. That's another story. Anyway, in one of her writing, she talked about how in the existence of God, God had to go through three humiliation. And that's fascinating. The first humiliation is the incarnation. The God Almighty should come into the world like a baby, fully dependent on his earthly mother, Mary, for survival. Yeah, if you read the Bible, that's clearly what we understand Jesus to be. Unlike those gods of other mythology and other kind of local religions, we don't have a Jesus Christ who was born with many arms or many eyes or many head and multiple supernatural flying through the air kind of thing. We don't have any of that thing. So it's a humiliation of God that in order to save us, he had to be incarnate. And not only incarnate, he had to be a man of sorrow, exactly as Isaiah tells us. And the second humiliation of God is the cross. the God Almighty should be crucified by his creatures. And, you know, as Jesus said, if he wanted to, he can summon 12 legions of angels, which is like 186,000 angels, just to let you know. It's just incredible. And yet he willingly allowed his creatures to crucify him and humiliate him and spit on him and finally kill him. But it is the third humiliation of God that is most fascinating to me. Dorothy Sayers says that the third humiliation of God is the church. That God Almighty should be represented by people such as you and I. Now, this observation is a very profound observation. What she was trying to say is that, you know, God could do anything. He can distribute anything he wants. He can basically just change the world with a snap of his mind and allow all the world's problems to be solved. However, by his perfect wisdom, and I want to emphasize that is his perfect wisdom, he has allowed people like you, people like me, to be his eyes and his ears and his mouth, his hand and his feet. And we represent him on earth. Dorothy Sayers pointed out that, my goodness, what a horrible and rotten job that we are doing, isn't it? Because there's problems aplenty all over the places. It's not just about physical poverty and distribution issues. It's also problem relating to our family, the way we bring out our children, the way we demonstrate values or not, the way we deal with our colleague, the way we deal with our boss, our subordinates, our neighbors, so many, many things. We're just messing it up, really. And God allow it to happen because it is our role to represent him. And it's a very, very scary thought, in my opinion. And sometimes I think about why we qualify to be called children of God. It's a very strange thing. I mean, if you are listening to this, you probably have a job with FIES organization or the affiliated companies, and you know, you in order to get that job, you have some qualification needed, right? I don't know about your recruitment guy. Maybe ask you what university you come from, what's your GPA, how well do you do? Are you very good at this? Are you very good at that? And you know, that's the way things are. And in Singapore, especially, if you want to, for example, be a politician, the People's Action Party is very stringent. They expect you to, you know, have a lot of stellar things, whether you're from a top university or at least be very successful in your career. Remember one of our top leaders say anybody who's making less than 500,000 a year is not that great. I don't agree, of course, but you know, that's how people look at it. And yet, to be a child of God, it's so simple, isn't it? Anyone can be a child of God. How do you become a child of God? Romans chapter 10 says, if you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you confess with your mouth that he is Lord, and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead. That's it. It's that simple, you know. So it's quite crazy. And in the end, the church is indeed, to a large extent, a humiliation to God. But guess what? God's not going to let it be like this, because by his perfect wisdom, he allowed us to take on the responsibility to help people make in his image and likeness. And when we do not do it, guess what will happen? He will allow the situation to worsen. You don't feed some guy who's living right beside you, who is starving to death. God is very unlikely to work a miracle and feed that guy by miracle. God wants you to be his hand and his representative on earth. And if you so choose not to do it, I've got news for you, that person is going to starve to death. However, that's not the end of the story, because the Bible in Matthew is very clear, tells us that he will then hold us accountable. In Matthew chapter 25, Jesus Christ did not give a parable, but he illustrated, I would use the word incident or event or prophesy something that will happen. He didn't say this is a parable. He said, when the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, he will sit on his glorious throne. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate the people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. So here the illustration is that the sheep are the good ones, the goats are the evil ones. And in this illustration, the famous verse came in, and the king will tell both the sheep and the goat, "For I was hungry and you gave me something to eat." Now, first to the sheep, "I was hungry, you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, you invited me in. I needed clothes and you clothed me. I was sick and you looked after me. I was in prison and you came to visit me." Now, we prayerfully, we are a bit familiar with this passage. If you're not familiar, the sheep will then ask him, "Hey, when did we see you hungry? When did we see you thirsty? When did we see you a stranger? When did we see you naked? When were you in jail? I mean, you are God, right? And when were you needed someone to help you?" And the king said, "Well, I was helped by the sheep." Towards the goats, the king said, "I was hungry and you gave me nothing to eat. I was thirsty and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, you did not invite me in. I needed clothes and you did not clothe me. I was sick and in prison and you did not look after me." And this was to the goat. So same thing, the goats protest and said, "Hey, what are you talking about? You are God, you know, you are invisible. How am I going to, when would I see you? I have never met you before. I've never seen you hungry. I've never seen you thirsty. I have never recognize you as a stranger. I've never seen you naked. I've never known that you were ever sick. I didn't know that you were in prison. None of these things had happened." And the answer came from the king towards the sheep. He said, "Truly I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did it for me." And to the goat, the king will say, "Truly, I tell you, whatever you did not do for one of these least of these, you did not do for me." My dear brothers and sisters in Christ, you know, there are many Bible passages that are pretty scary. And I always feel that this passage is one of the scariest ones. What this passage basically says is that, you know, when you say help the poor, it's not so simple, you know. It's not just help some poor soul out there or whatever it is. This passage equates that person with God. And this was the understanding of many of the greats, including people like Mother Teresa. Now, she's a Roman Catholic. I'm a Protestant pastor. There are differences in theology, of course. But I tell you, I have deep respect for the work that she did. And of course, now the Roman Catholic Church has canonized her as a saint. One of the things that Mother Teresa would do is that she's in Calcutta. So now she's Saint Teresa of Calcutta. She will go every single morning out into the street to pick up the dying from the drain, from the roadside. It's a horrible thing because they got so many homeless people that people are dying on the street. And she will bring these dying people back to her shelter. And she and the other sisters will spend a lot of time picking up the maggots from their wound, cleaning them up, you know, comforting them. Do you know for what purpose? So that they will die with dignity. Not that they will recover, because some of these people are like almost completely dead already. And so, you know, for pragmatic people, they think about things like that. They say like, come on, why are you wasting your time? You're going to die anyway. Leave them there for a few hours. They will die on their own. Why are you going to bother to go and clean them up and pick up maggots and clean their wounds or comfort them? You're going to die anyways. The end result is exactly the same. Mother Teresa's answer was most moving. Mother Teresa said, "Because I see Jesus in their eyes." Because I see Jesus in their eyes. So when we help the poor and those who are needy, surely they are better than the least among these brothers, right? They are better than the least. But the king say, if you help the least, you are actually doing it for me. Let us never, ever forget that. You serve God by serving people made in his image and likeness. And you're talking about the least among them or somehow. You love God by loving people made in his image and likeness. And the Bible doesn't say that they are Christians, because not only Christians are made in the image and likeness of God, but all of humanity, including non-believers, they too are made in the image and likeness of God. Richard Stern kind of paraphrased this particular passage and put it this way. Let me move this down a little bit so you can see. For I was hungry while you had all you need. I was thirsty, but you drank bottled water. I was a stranger and you wanted me deported. I needed clothes, but you needed more clothes. I was sick and you pointed out the behavior that led to my sickness. I was in prison and you said I was getting what I deserve. Now, this is an excerpt from his book, The Hole in Our Gospel, What Does God Expect of Us? So in summary then, what is it that we are talking about? May I suggest that we are called to action? First, please know the word. Don't just because people tell you that it's like this or like that, you think that is the case. And including what I say, by the way, go check the word of God carefully to see if what I'm telling you is from his word. And may I suggest also do more and talk less, discuss less. We are forever discussing nonstop, right? Don't do that. Be consistent and holistic in reaching out to the poor, not an ad hoc and piecemeal kind of a thing to do. Like, okay, after listening to me, you feel very warm and fuzzy. And so you say, okay, I'm going to visit the poor this weekend or help in some shelter or some volunteering work. After that, no more already. Or you do it during Christmas, Chinese New Year, you know, those are the things that always happen. But guess what? The people who need help are there every single day. So think about your life. Think about what is it that God is calling you to do. Plan for it a little bit better. And overall wise, do live in for a cause that is larger than self. And I will, yeah, I will go on and on about this. This is not something which you can really explain enough in a short session like this. But all in all, remember that at the end of the day, the word of God is true in this. The Lord Jesus Christ himself said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. You want blessings from God, which I know we all want, then give more. Give of your money, give of your life, give of your talent, give of your time. I guarantee you, when you do more of that, the more you do it, the more you will understand scripture, and then the more you will do it even more. May the Lord bless us all so that our eyes are open to the fact that we do really need to love him and we do really need to serve him, and we love him and serve him primarily to the loving and serving of people made in his image and likeness. Amen. Let's end the session now. We want to sing a most wonderful song, my all-time favorite song. That's the advantage of being the guy who hosts Be Thou My Vision. right, wonderful. Let's close with a word of prayer. May I invite you, wherever you are, to join me in prayer. After the sharing, would you ask God to reveal to you, maybe the people around you who need your help, so that you can reach out and help them and to share the gospel with them and share your life with them, share your material possession with them, give them ready help, not just warm and fuzzy words. So spend some time thinking about the people around you. Maybe they are your neighbor, your colleague, somebody that you know in some home, some NGO, some charity, whatever the case may be. And think through what is it that God may want you to consistently be involved in. I mean, everybody got some passion about something. So maybe you want to seek that passion, okay? And then I'll lead you in closing prayer. Let's pray together. Let's pray together. We thank you, God, for guiding us to this session that we have had. And we do pray that you speak to us in our hearts. For we know that there are so many people that are around us, made in your image and likeness. And they are probably in very disadvantaged position compared to us. Grant to us the love we need, the grace we need, the strength we need, the wisdom we need to share our lives, not just in words, but certainly in deeds, so that this world will end up to be a better place than what we have found it to be. And that when we shall see you again, we will be known as a good and faithful servant. Instead of the goats that will be condemned, may we be the sheep that will be accepted by you fully. Let's receive God's blessing together. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and grant you peace. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each and every one of you and your loved ones as well, from now until we shall see him face to face. Amen. Okay, thank you folks for joining me. I hope to see you again soon. Remember, God is but a prayer away, and your chaplain is just one email or one WhatsApp away. All right, thank you. See you again. Bye-bye.